This is the BlahCade Pinball Podcast. I'm your host, Chris Freebus, a.k.a. Shut Your Trap. Joining me, as always, halfway across the world, why, it's Jared Morgan.
Howdy ho.
Howdy ho.
All right. So, folks, we had a little bit of a gap, you might say, with our recording.
And it's all my fault.
It is all Jared's fault, but that's okay.
Because I had scheduling issues.
Yes. So the fact that Jared has scheduling issues, we wanted to get onto a schedule that works for Jared. Just giving you guys a heads up, we're going to be pretty much now on an every 2 week schedule, every other week, which means, unfortunately, I'm sorry to say, yes, Zen is going to be having another one of their, the pinball show, this upcoming week. We will be reacting to it, just not as quickly as some of you might hope for.
Yeah, that's right. So but we'll be doing it.
Yeah, we'll be doing it. It'll just be the week after it comes out. Yeah. Just in case any of you. I wanted to get that out of the way right now. You know.
Because what's interesting is I was having a bit of a look over the YouTube stats, Chris, and that was a very popular episode. Like us dissecting out the information from the pinball show. So we'll obviously keep doing that for you folks. Because you seem to enjoy it, our rampant speculation from a show. I reckon we'll be able to get another 60 minutes out of a 20 minute show.
Oh, I'm sure that we'll be up for that. And it also kind of depends. I mean, I guess the thing is, really. I don't think that we're going to be getting any like super hot news this time around. Having a new pinball effects drop, you know, that obviously requires an immediate response.
Yeah, that's right. We can't muck around with that.
But I don't expect that Zen's going to be doing that kind of a drop every single episode.
I mean, it'd be great if they did.
But... it would be for us, especially for content. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Perfect.
So anyway, that's the heads up. I had a couple of people message me going, "What's going on with you guys? How come you?"
Are you dead? Yeah. What's going on?
We're just aligning the show to match scheduling issues. Because, again, life gets in the way, and it doesn't help us being on literally opposite sides of the world.
It is tricky. Hey, I don't know, Chris, if you've noticed the new addition to the artwork behind me at the moment.
You know, I saw a post that you did that obviously shows them in much clearer view. But, yes, Jared has decorated his room with some... Rick and Morty and some Beavis and Butthead, but there's things inside their heads.
Yeah, there's stuff on top of their heads, and it's from this Art is for Losers exhibition that was at Netherworld. And there's something about the posters, the art, you could buy the prints for like $25 or the framed originals for $80, and they were gone. Like the $80 ones were snapped up probably, I think, on the day of those prints because they're very popular. The prints were $25, so I just went and got, you know, the pigeon pears and went down to IKEA and got like the really nice frames for $15, and there you go. I've got a nice little art collection there now for like less than about, I don't know, 160 Australian, so not bad.
If you want a better view of those, well, that's where you
get onto my Insta.
You go onto his Insta, or because I don't really do my Instagram, but I saw him on Jared's Twitter.
Yeah, I was on Twitter. Yeah, I posted in both places. So check out the little one thing down the bottom there. Sorry, this side.
Yeah, there you go. There you go. I know it's hard when you don't mirror yourself
backwards. Backwards. This way. Yeah.
Yeah. Something.
So
like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, check them out. They're really cool. So yeah, I hope they do more art installations like that because I've got bare walls that I need to fill.
What else has been going on in the gap there? For those of you, you know, I'll mention these things now and then, things that I've been watching. For those of you that, in these COVID times have just, you're at wit's end and you need something to really brighten your day but still not pandering to you. I highly recommend that show, Ted Lasso. It's like a bright,
it's so good.
It's like a bright ray of sunshine. It is never mean, and yet it is thoroughly adult.
Oh, it's properly adult, and it's not about soccer, or sorry, football. If you're in the UK, it's based around that sport. But this was what put me off the show initially when watching it. But then so many people told me you have to watch Ted Lasso, and I did, and I went, why did I wait so long? Like it was such a good show. And I I don't know if they're doing another one. But
no, I'm sure they're doing another season. But it's not just that the content is good. Like I said, it's also one of those just you're never feeling a sense of dread while watching it. Instead, you're kind of like, oh, I wonder how it's going to work out. It's not, yes. Oh, I wonder when things are going to turn bad. It's, no, how are things going to work out?
Yeah, because the thing is that like the shows, when it starts, it's already pretty bad. So they can only go up from where they start the series.
Yeah.
You know, so it's about the rise to glory, I guess. And it's great.
Yeah.
It's very nuanced.
It's fantastic. So I just wanted to throw that out there for those of you that are looking for some viewing that will uplift you but not pander to you at the same time.
Absolutely. So definitely two thumbs up.
Two thumbs up. There you go. You doing the two thumbs up just remind, I don't know if you guys over there in Australia, don't know why you would know of them, but back in the day, Siskel and Ebert, they were famous.
Oh yeah, that's my reference to it.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay. Somebody has gone and found their old movie reviews for classic, like Empire Strikes Back or Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Wow.
And yeah.
They've been at it for a long time, right?
Oh God, yeah, they were. Yeah, very long time. They tried to. They found the best video source, of theirs, try and clean up the VHS waves and all that stuff. But then whenever they go to the movie clip, they throw in the full, HD version of the movie clip that they're talking about, which is kind of jarring, but it's kind of cool at the same time because I don't know if they're showing exactly what they were showing. I mean, it's definitely the same moment, but I don't know if they were showing that long of the clip that they were doing, but it's still kind of cool to just see it like, oh, hey, that's much better than watching some bad wavy pan and scan version of what they were talking about.
Exactly. It's funny. We've got a similar sort of movie couple here in Australia. They're called Margaret Pomerantz and David Stratton, and they've been doing this show on the Special Broadcasting Service, or SBS as it's known here, for years as well. Probably not as long as those two dudes, but still a very long time. Like, they were doing it when I was a kid, and I'm 41, so they've been at this for a long time. And their show is called The Movie Show, and they have just reviewed a pile of movies, like David Stratton, and like he's just the movie critic for Australia, I think.
And there you go. So there's the extent of our movie talk and entertainment talk today. We're going to dive into our typical pinball talk. Today's show is going to be a little bit critical, possibly.
It is, and I'm sure we're probably going to get flack for it.
Yeah. So pull up your britches, and but this is not meant to. It's not meant to slam anybody. It's more meant to try and give a listen. And try and improve.
And the thing is,
constructive criticism. Let's put it that way.
It definitely will be. I think we'll both pick each other up if we're being too negative. But I think we know the pattern that we want to go for with this. So I think we'll be okay. But the thing is, the subject we're going to be talking about, there's definitely a pattern out there that this company does actually listen. And I think, based on that, there might be a hope.
Yes.
That perhaps some of our thoughts we are just two people. Obviously they will need to listen to this with a grain of salt and do what they want with it, if they even listen at all. But it's still going to be interesting, I think.
Spoiler alert, we're going to talk about AtGames.
Yeah. Yeah.
But let's first talk about some issues that are kind of coming up with both AtGames and Arcade 1-Up with their pinball, and that is shipping and delivery. So
it's not easy.
No. Currently, with Arcade 1-Up, the Star Wars pinball cab has been arriving in people's homes. They have been getting those shipments. Unfortunately, some of those people are then going and posting that their DMD screen is having mixing pixels, or there's issues with the main monitor, like just plain cutting out or being hyper bright.
Yeah, some real contrast issues and color issues with some of these monitors coming out.
And I don't know if I'm hoping this is just a rare occurrence, not across the board occurrence. It's hard to tell when, because who usually posts these things? People that are complaining, people that love their product don't sit there and go, "Oh yeah, my contrast is perfect," and that be their post, because nobody wants to read that.
Yeah, no one cares.
Nobody cares.
That's a problem. Like when you're right, Chris. Like this, the problem you have is when you're looking at these Facebook forums, it's usually negativity or problems. Sometimes, depending on the forum, it is positivity and, hey, look, I love my game. The Toy Shop forum actually is normally pretty positive. There's a lot of happy customers with that.
But then everybody goes, yeah, you're a homer. It's in your home. Of course you're going to love it.
Yeah, exactly. So, but, you know, there you go. Take it as you will.
But I do want to just point out something that I know is not available on the Arcade 1-Up cabinet. This would be a software thing. So, hi, Zen. There should be... Actually, the hardware end would be Arcade 1-Up. You should offer the ability to change the brightness and contrast on the monitor. That should just be
a absolutely.
I don't know why that's not a setting.
Yep. Because, like, it needs... I don't know how they would do it. Like, whether they just have physical control somewhere, or whether they're working in the software.
Here,
do they do it on the Arcade 1-Ups?
On the cab that I have, if you go into the back and you reach up, there is actually contrast and brightness that you can mess with. It's not easy to get to, and you would need literally two people, one person standing at the front going, "Yeah, I like that," and the other person physically doing the control.
it's like tuning the aerial on the roof. Like, yes. You have to have someone going, "Yeah, that's good. Okay, a little bit to the left."
Yeah, so not ideal. Just put it in there as
accessibly
so that people can change it accordingly, because I did that indeed. The Street Fighter, it was way too washed out for me.
It was blown out. Yeah.
And so I knocked it down quite a bit, and got it to more my liking, sacrificing the lower end, like, you know, how much you move your head, what is still showing. But
yeah,
I mean, there are sacrifices you make, but I still think it should be a software option right there. In the options.
Or, if there's some way of tying it into the actual software itself, they actually have an interface into the monitor. But,
right.
I mean, I don't know if... There's one thing we're not sure about with the Arcade 1-Up screens is if they do have the tuning controls on the monitor, or whether it's just a panel and that's it.
Right.
Hopefully, someone will actually flip the top up. I'm sure Mel could tell us, because he's got one of these cabinets. We could probably ask him a question to see if there is tuning controls on it.
Now, the part that I wish that Zen would step in, because I'm hearing this and seeing examples on YouTube, the nudging and the sensitivity of it.
Oh, yeah.
I really do think that you should be allowed to
tweak
the sensitivity of your nudging, as opposed to just being on or off. And the reason that I say that is, even when you're using a controller and you go ahead and you do your nudge, well, if I do a harsh nudge, it does a full strength nudge. If I do soft, it does a soft nudge. On my PinSim cabinet, I actually went into Windows and I was able to tune what the accelerometer sensitivity was. Because at first it was literally, if I pushed the button, it would tilt. I'm like, all I did was I pushed my button, so I had to knock down the sensitivity on that. So I know that it functions and plays, and, you know, that should be, if they should do some degrees of nudge, I just think. Allow it.
There is,
and that's something that AtGames has in theirs.
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah, well, that's, yeah, I think that's definitely something that Arcade 1-Up should sort out. I think this sounds like there is a calibration option in the Arcade 1-Up cabinet, although not having used it, I don't know what it does. Like, whether it will actually level things out for you if you actually calibrate again when it's installed, I don't know. So, because, you know, we don't have the cabinet, so we can't trust it. So, unfortunately, we're living vicariously through everyone else at the moment.
Which, by the way, it can be exceedingly frustrating, because a lot of the comments that we read and hear, we're like, clearly you've never played these games on PC. or you've never played digital pinball at all.
At all.
Or this you don't understand what they're trying to achieve. And so I know that one of the things that Jared was commenting on this past week, somebody was complaining about, oh, it's in the arcade one-up cab in theory is really only a 15-inch monitor because that's how much of the actual play field is filling up.
You have.
And they were talking about the Star Wars cabs.
Yeah. I just couldn't quite get that. It's like, no.
Because they were complaining there's too much dead space apron. In the apron. Well, here's the thing. It's a wide-body table.
Yeah, it's a wide-body table.
Most of the Star Wars tables are wide-body tables.
Yeah, they are. And not only that, but like they were designed for PC play. They were designed for PS4 and Xbox. Like, and what they've done is they've gone and put them into a pinball machine using an adjusted cabinet mode. But these machines were fantasy tables. They were made-up tables that Zen have done. And they're not the same as a regular standard size apron Bally Williams table, for example. So
right.
It's part of the aesthetic of these tables that, yes, you do have a lot of apron area because they often put a lot of animated characters and features onto that apron. Like, it actually acts in a lot of places like a stage for these characters to interact on. So it's purposely designed like that. And while you may think that the play field is smaller, it doesn't actually detract from the gameplay at all. Like, the way that they've designed the game and the shots and the shot making and everything like that, it's designed to work within that form factor flawlessly. So while your visibility or your play area may be reduced, they've actually catered for that in the design of the table.
Yeah.
Because, you know, remember that these tables, when they're originally released, they were designed to be played in landscape format, not portrait format. So just to, like, if you've never played these before as a consumer, and you're wondering what it was like on a landscape screen, think about that. Like, you're actually, if you're using that analogy, it's probably like a 5-centimeter play field. If you think about the way it's actually oriented on a landscape screen. So I don't really know how to answer that question except saying that it's by design. So,
well, and, you know, quit comparing it to things that were designed for, you know, their reproductions from an actual cabinet kind of thing. I don't know. I mean, the option would be to have a wider cabinet, I guess. I don't know. That's where you're dealing with trying to cram something into the confines of a 16x9 monitor.
You know? Yes.
All right. Those are the... Oh, yeah. So those are kind of the issues that Arcade 1UP is having right now. Nobody has received their Marvel pinball yet.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody really knows when their Attack from Mars cabinets are coming, which sold out like that on Best Buy's pre-order.
Yeah.
Other than Jared, you seem to have seen something.
I did actually see on Twitter, and I think Mel actually retweeted it saying that's hot. But it was a Marvel and a Star Wars cabinet side by side with some topper.
Oh, that was Cool Toys, Doug's. Yeah, Doug had both of his side by side, just kind of showing off his fandom. Yeah.
Yeah. And that looked really nice. Like, having them together like that, it makes you go, I might. I don't know if I could just have one.
Because he got the Marvel cab for review, and then he had ordered the Star Wars cab. So that's why That's why he's got both.
That's why
of those.
He's got two. Yeah. That's right.
So who knows? That. There's a possibility that mid March, I guess, AFM might start shipping. That's based off of some date that Jared saw.
Well, put it this way, I'm going to be having a look around Costco every day, around from about 17th of March onwards. To see if I could spot one of these things in the wild. And if I see one, I'll absolutely take photos of it for you guys.
Now, on the flip side, should point out, we heard some numbers about Arcade 1UP and what the demand for these things are. It's rather astounding. Completely threw them off guard. It's nothing but good. We'll get into why it's nothing but good in just a moment, because it's also nothing but good for AtGames. Same situation. They are blowing through. They're on their fourth wave of accepting pre-orders.
That's
fourth wave.
They've got to be happy about that, right?
Like, yeah.
The risk they took on this product is well and truly paying off. Just as IK1UP's gamble was.
And exactly.
Like, almost like round of applause to everyone.
Right.
For backing it. Because right. this means it opens up a huge amount of opportunities for these companies to innovate in this space. So, yeah.
Now, unfortunately, really they're still only taking payments from the Wave 1 people.
Well,
the Wave yeah. 4 people, I think they said that they could maybe expect sometime around May that they'd be catching delivery. Here's the bummer with that. They're supposed to hit retail in about June. Now, I mean, obviously, hey, you want to pre-order so that you guarantee you get it rather than, you know, stocking a store waiting for their shipments to come in to be able to potentially get one. But it is kind of a rub that if you're doing that Wave 4 and you get yours in May and you paid the $100 to $200 of shipping on this thing, only to then find out that, oh, I could have just gone down the block and picked it up myself and saved myself that money. That's kind of a bummer.
That will sting a little bit. But I think, you know, the people who are hanging around, the people who are actually going, I want to get in on a Wave 4, probably already understand, you know what, I'm doing this pre-order so I can guarantee to get it, and I'm going to wear the $200 shipping or whatever it is, $100, just so I get it.
Yeah, I mean, that is the whole point of a pre-order.
Exactly right. It is like
saving yourself a headache. Unfortunately, you're
headaches... You're going to get it sometime.
Yeah.
You know.
Unfortunately, headaches have hit some of the users in terms of... So, AtGames is constantly, from what everybody posted, they're constantly doing updates on this. I guess one of the last updates bricked the unit for everybody.
Yeah, that's not ideal.
when I say bricked, I'm not saying that it completely foobarred it to the point of now it doesn't work. It's not Red Ring of Death bricking.
Yes, Red Ring. Yes.
Yeah, we haven't heard the Red Ring of Death in a while, have we?
That's right. That's a blast from the past.
But instead, it was just making it so that they couldn't play anything on their cabinet.
Yeah, it just wouldn't boot.
You could
access. You could access the update bootloader system, but just you couldn't play. There was something wrong with the ROM.
And the sad part is that means even the things that you were offline had loaded into your cab, you were not able to play. So people were having to basically revert to default initial factory setting and then
roll back
and then waiting for the next update to roll out so that they could tweak and go forward. I mean, these things happen, obviously.
I've only got one thing to say about this. Software's hard.
It is.
Rolling updates, you know, across, even if you control your own hardware ecosystem like AtGames do, there's always going to be some problem. So, you know,
that being said, it is a little worrisome. The fingers of AtGames constantly poking at your unit.
Well, yes. I don't know whether you could, and anyone with an AtGames cabinet, please do confirm this. I wonder if you could optionally say, let me install updates when I want, rather than automatically deploy them. Because if that was the case, I would almost be the cautious consumer and enable that feature. So I could basically have all the bleeding edge early adopters confirm that the thing doesn't brick my system.
Yeah, exactly.
that's the pro tip. If it's available for me, that's what you do. having fallen victim to that several times with software updates.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So let's get to the good news with all this.
Mm. Yeah.
Obviously, both these companies are far exceeding what they thought that the demand for this stuff would be, which is fantastic. I mean, who thought that pinball would be doing this? And obviously, both of them were probably basing their numbers off of, you know, their arcade cabs, I would think.
Yeah, well, that's the only bit of actual data they have, so they'd probably be doing that, I would think.
So it's interesting that the pinball cabs, I don't know if they're doing necessarily better at, you know, right off the bat from what the arcade cabs did, but it seems to definitely have caught them off guard.
I think so. Yeah. I think they're a little surprised at how much people want one of these things.
So what does that mean for us? Well, let's look at in terms of, let's start with AtGames, start with the Arcade 1-Up and what that means, especially with Zen involved. You can almost guarantee that there's going to be I would say they're going to brand it Jurassic Park. Just because that will sell in retail, but it's a universal licensed table. with all the universes stuff in it. I can almost guarantee that that's rolling forward. And people have found box art that indicated that.
I don't know
if it was Photoshopped, but...
Well, probably. Yeah. The internet's pretty good at Photoshopping.
Yes. It's hard to believe when you don't see it directly from the source. But it also means that... Can you imagine... This would make purchasing something like, let's say, Adam's Family, you know, paying for that license, would make so much more sense, because you know that that cab would sell like hotcakes, and the stores would probably want that actually in their stores.
I wouldn't be able to predict how many units of those they would sell. I don't think there would be a ceiling to it. Like, they could mint thousands of them and they would sell.
Right. Like, so basically it takes the risk from Zen and from Arcade 1-Up, because they would have to also secure the licensing, but it takes that risk away from them in terms of having to pay what might be an exorbitant price for the license, to know that, hey, there's a big customer base though waiting for exactly that. So it makes it a lot easier to approve sort of thing. It also, I think, opens up the door for, again, take Adam's Family. Boom, you pay for that license, you put that on, slap that on a cab. Now what other tables are you going to fill on with it? Here come your Zen originals that are unlicensed. You know, you throw those on. Those just become the bonus gravy. You know what I mean?
Exactly. Like, you've got your core table of Adam's Family, and then maybe one other Belly Williams table to complement it, and then a whole lot of other ancillary tables. And, you know, we see that model with Arcade 1-Up with their cabinets with multiple versions of, pardon me, Pac-Man on, and then some random game.
Well, just look at what they did with, what are they calling it, the Midway Legends cab with the Mortal Kombat, and it's got... Mm. All these Midway titles slopped in. Yeah. I mean, it's a 12-in-1 cab.
That thing has just been, like, according to the AtGames, and the AtGames, I switch between these so easily, sorry. The Arcade 1-Up.
Quit naming your companies with both starting with A.
Hey, it's hard. Too many A's, man. Too many A's. Anyhow, so yeah, Arcade 1-Up, like, announced, they were a little bit surprised at just how well that product was received in the marketplace. And they go, like, you know, it's like so in demand. So that's a really good indication that people want these, like, really quite marquee label brands. And why shouldn't that translate to pinball? Like, you know, it's such an obvious thing. You're right. Like, it makes a lot of sense.
So there's where it's a good thing for Zen having the licenses that they do, or the ability to go after certain licenses that they do, that it makes it less dangerous. That they're not going to earn their money back for the outlay.
Reduces risk dramatically. Right. Yeah.
With AtGames, I think it opens up the whole possibility of what people are willing to pay for their hardware. And
because that's really the value proposition that that AtGames is all about. They're not necessarily about the software included. They're about the possibilities with the hardware, and that's really their selling point. So you're right. It's going to be very interesting.
Because hopefully they will invest more in that initial design phase, or just, you know, further design. Maybe in terms of, I mean, I keep on coming back to it, but just like that whole idea of where they put their ports on.
That needs a bit of reconsideration.
Come on, you know what you're really selling. We all know what you're really selling. You're not selling this cabinet with the software that's in it. You're selling this cabinet for the potential of what software it can play based off of what people plug into it. So put the plug in a place that works when connecting to a computer, so that you're not seeing these gross cables coming off the top of the machine.
Everywhere.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's 100% true.
Spend a little bit more on the design phase. And get those features that make it so much easier for those add-ons that people are wanting to do. And we're going to get into... AtGames put out a survey.
Yeah.
And this survey is rather telling, right? In terms of where AtGames' head is at. And I think especially knowing what their marketplace is, that it opens up a lot of possibilities. So we're going to get to the survey. We're going to take it here.
Yeah. We're going to do it live.
Do it live. Yes. Yeah.
I believe it's actually closed now, officially. They were taking responses up until Friday, I think. Right. So,
yeah. I mean, I copied it and, so no, we're not. I already submitted my thoughts. I'm sure.
So did I.
Too. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, totally.
But thought it would be fun to just kind of do as a talking point for us. So we're going to get to that. But there is some things that AtGames is doing that I think will help inform the survey. And I'm wanting to kind of talk about some of these, because the more and more I see these things, the more and more I realize that the AtGames, and all this is really kind of aimed directly at the Legends Pinball. It's not aimed at their Ultimate Arcade, although a lot of it, this conversation kind of goes that direction. But I truly believe that the Legends Pinball, it's a loss leader. They knock the price really low, because now I'm seeing the prices of all the add-ons. And the prices of the add-ons are like, holy crap, you gotta be kidding me.
They are not cheap at all.
So they just did their Owner's Day, National Owner's Day. I think it was the second time that they've done this. And so they revealed some product and pricing and things like that. So I thought we might take a look
at the add-ons and stuff.
So let's look at the main add-on that is for the Legends Pinball, and that is this. It is a proper joystick
control panel,
with fighting stick buttons and the trackball, basically allowing you to play all those other games that you can play on their ArcadeNet service.
Yes.
This is the kind of add-on that we had heard that Arcuda was going to be wanting to put onto their unit.
Swappable, that's right.
It's the apron.
Modular play field.
Makes a lot of sense.
A lot of sense.
How much would you pay for this item, Jared? I'll show you another picture of this item, which I believe is...
This is what you get out of the box. Yep.
So that would just drop in, plug a cable in, boom, you're ready to go. Slap the edges back on and drop it in.
Everything, as you can see, all you see is the Perspex top of the thing. You don't see all the ugly naked wood and stuff.
Right.
So
you're going to see it just like that.
Yeah, it looks just like that. Nice and clean, nice and neat. Looks, I don't know, I reckon, it looks like everything looks pretty decent on there, like the buttons and everything. I'd go like $100 US for that.
That's what I would tend to think. $100 US would seem fair. No, they want $200 US.
What?
Which seems rather exorbitant. Now, I kind of believe what they're thinking here is they have their Legends Gamer deck, that just kind of sits onto your lap.
Yeah.
And I think that's probably about how much that one is. And so it's almost like maybe they don't want to price one too low to devalue the other. Except for, I would say, but the only way this thing works is if you plug it into the Legends Pinball that you already purchased.
It's got no embedded games in it. It's just a control panel.
Yeah.
So not sure if... I mean, probably, when you think of the cost, probably... the actual circuit board with all the games on it, and that actually isn't that much more. It's probably the hardware that is where most of the cost is.
Hardware, you figure the joystick, the joystick and buttons, you can buy that on Amazon for $25.
Yeah, the trackball is probably a different matter.
Trackball costs a little bit more.
Like, $50?
Yeah, but that's, again, not buying in bulk.
Yeah, but would that be how much it would cost to buy one? Just
I think it's around $40. They range between $40 and $90. I doubt that they're using the really high grade trackball.
No, I don't think so.
And this doesn't even have a spinner dial on it, which is also kind of interesting.
Like their Legends Arcade Sue.
Nor do you have the ability to do two player.
No.
You know, two joysticks. So I don't know. I think that 200 is steep. That is steep.
Yeah.
I do want to point out.
It'll sell, though.
No, yeah, it'll sell. You see this little cutout area here? I believe this is where the exciter goes.
Yep, that will be where it goes.
There's a complaint people have been having with the exciter, because obviously all you're attaching to is this thin piece of plastic or mason or I don't know what it is, Lexan. Anyway,
yeah.
Again, it's a speaker.
Yeah.
Speakers vibrate.
Just snap.
And people have been complaining that if you put it on the volume on anything but low, all you hear is the rattling. Pops. You don't even hear.
Pops all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
But if you put it on low, then you can't feel it.
So, yep. What's the point? I can't really be complimentary about the way they've handled that.
I think the exciter was an afterthought. I think that honestly, I believe that they didn't think that 1UP was going to pull it off.
And yeah, with the solenoids.
With the solenoids. I don't believe that they thought that they were going to pull it off, and then all of a sudden 1UP did pull it off, and they went, oh crap, well, we did say we were going to put haptic. I guess we have to do this. And then they quickly discovered that you can't just put it under wood, because nobody will ever feel that. It needs to be closer. And then
they wouldn't have factored in the fact that, you know, to integrate solenoids like Arcade 1UP did, you've actually got to code that.
Yeah.
Or at least have a special interface board, which would have blown out their bill of materials.
Which is, I was just going to say, sorry, folks, Farsight nor Zacharia coded for solenoids. All they've coded for is controller, rumble, and the audio. The exciters are based entirely off of audio, which here comes downfall number two.
Here's the rub.
Here's the rub. Farsight's, all their stuff is in mono.
Yeah.
So
there's no positional, you cannot tap into any stereo feed positionally and work out where things to fire.
You flipping the left flipper, you feel it still in your right hand.
Yeah.
It's not stereo.
It's not directional.
No.
This is the advantage with that Zen has here, is that all their mechanical effects are stereophonic.
Yeah.
And they are positional, which makes me wonder, I wonder if that's how they managed their solenoid, like positional solenoids, and worked out where to fire it based on their mechanical noises. I think it's probably more advanced than that. I think they would have.
I do too. I don't think they're doing it off of audio. I think it's coding.
I think it's actually probably almost tapping into the switch triggers for each of those objects. Mm-hmm. Because they have very, very deep integration into the software. Like, that's how they can do pop-up scores and stuff like that when pop bumpers are firing. Like, as an aside, that's the thing that really surprised me with Belly Williams when I started playing those tables, and you had the first pop-up score set to one, so everything scored. Like, just seeing the difference in how each of these things scored based on what you were doing in the game was really kind of fascinating to me.
Right, because you don't realize...
You don't.
Where a lot of your score comes from.
No, you go, oh, well, that's actually pretty lucrative if you shoot it up there. So it was, it's kind of really neat. Anyhow, circling back to the original discussion, the whole mono-based sound is tricky. Now, I think Zacharia, they do actually have stereophonic effects for their mechanical sounds for memory. Playing with cans on, I'm pretty sure... Like these on, you can hear that the left flippers actually are left aligned and the right ones are right. So perhaps when Zacharia comes along and folks can actually get those loaded onto the ALP, or that might actually then start to pay off with those exciters, hopefully. But the fact that their underlying design being that close to the control panel and the vibration aspect needs to be addressed in version 2 of this cabinet.
Yeah.
Really does. They really need to put some thought into it.
Okay, other accessories that you can purchase for, that you would maybe want to purchase for your Legends pinball also, based on what you have here. They have their light gun.
Oh. Right.
Now, this is kind of interesting. You're wondering, what the heck is this? Hey, look, more branding. Guys, really? Enough with the branding. Good lord.
Do you know what I've found? And this admittedly was in a an arcade one up forum, the Aussie one that I'm a member of, someone had posted a satirical post in there about they had a, I think it was a an AtGames cabinet and a arcade one up pinball cabinet.
Yeah, it was.
But the arcade one up, I don't know that it's pinball because it doesn't tell me it's pinball, and I don't know who it's made from because it doesn't have.
Yeah, how am I supposed to know who made this this item?
How am I even supposed to know that it's pinball because it doesn't have pinball plastered all over it? So, yeah, ease up. I guess it, you know, branding is important when you have a company, but there's a little bit too much sometimes. And I think maybe just dial back the logos a bit.
Now,
far less obtrusive if that was just black.
Right. You know? You may be wondering, what the heck is this thing up here anyway? It's basically a Wii sensor.
it's a light bar for the gun. Because
for the gun.
Light guns, unless you have a very specific type of light gun, can't use it on LCDs.
Yeah. Now, you know, hey, this selling something like this makes it good for, you know, legacy
gun shooters.
I'm saying for people that already have, you know, previous cabinets before that kind of tech came out, you know, so they're making it so that you're not leaving behind anybody that already had. So I applaud them for that. That's fine. It looks like it has a
little
thumbstick on the back.
Yep.
So for navigation purposes, I'm sure. Anyway, how much do you think this costs, Jared?
I reckon that it would probably be around 100.
It's 100.
Hey, I got it right.
Now, does that seem like a fair price to you? Again, look, seems a little steep to me.
Well, I don't know. I think that I'm trying to think back to the days when I had a PS2, and I wanted to buy Point Blank, and I needed to buy the Namco Gun Con. I think it was, well, with a game, I think down here it was about 120 Australian, and I think you could buy Gun Cons for about 50 or 60 Australian dollars. So with the US tax, i.e. the exchange rate, added on to that being about 130 Australian, thereabouts, it's probably a bit high.
If it came with two guns, I could see the price.
Then two guns, yeah.
Two guns, yes. But again, I'm coming back around to, I'm going to my, you know, Guitar Hero Rock Band peripheral days, where drum kit, microphone, and guitar, and the game sold for $120.
Yeah, I think it was about 170 or 180 here. So yeah, you could get the whole Rock Band for like under 200 here.
So there's some serious markup going on this item. I'm going to show you one other picture in just a second, but first we're going to go now for those of you that didn't purchase that you don't own the Legends Pinball, but instead you just own the Legends Ultimate. Well, then they sell pinball buttons, the pinball kit. These slap onto the side of the unit so that you can play pinball that way.
Yeah. Like from what I've seen, they have like little fingers and they just slides up.
Yeah.
So
$50 for that.
Okay. So that's what? About $15 a button. A little bit less.
I don't know. It looks like a 3D printed quickie. And there's nothing nice design wise about it. I don't know. It just. Oh. And I'm going to. Here, let me show you. Where is the picture that I want to show? That's that one. That's that one. That's that one. Oh my gosh. Where the heck is it? There it is. There's everything slapped on
to a cabinet.
To a cabinet. So you got your light gun here. You got your pinball controller here, which, I mean, I guess maybe they made the thickness so that it goes flush, that which makes sense. You got your light bar up here.
It's a light bar, like it almost looks like it is wireless. So you charge it and it somehow works with it. Because I don't see any cables or anything coming from it, unless they've deliberately not done that because they look gross and and they'll look horrible. I hope it's sort of wireless.
I mean, look, you have this USB here, connector. And I think I see shot. I see a USB here. Oh, you know what it is?
What?
You might be right. It might be. I think I was gonna say, do you hook this in and have it drop down to the your plugs?
I hope not. Oh.
Do you think? So now you're gonna have to make your tape your wire to the side here.
Oh please! Look, if somebody has one of these, always getting one. Please tell us that's not the case, because that's not nice. Oh, that's really. Oh no.
What do you want to bet?
Unfortunately, it'd be a lot of money.
Because how else is this thing going to talk to the unit other than being Wi-Fi?
It's got to be hardwired.
I would think it's got to be hardwired, so I think it's going to be drape your cable and.
So would the gun? How is the gun going to be cabled, or is it?
No, the gun would be wireless.
And that module would be its receiver.
Yes.
Don't know. Chris. Don't know. A little bit of gaffer tape around the black edges of your cabinet would probably solve that problem.
Yeah, sure. Why not? Okay. So right there, you've got light gun, $100, $200 for the controller panel, $600 for your Legends pinball. So we're at $900 right now. Right? Yeah. For all of this. Now, and this is where I every time I go to the AtGames website, I'm like, why you guys hide this stuff? Go ahead, try and find pricing about what the monthly service fee is for your AtGames or the ArcadeNet service.
Mm.
I'll just tell you, it's $20 a month. You can buy it at 6 month blocks, which will knock it off to half off. So you're still talking $120 a year. Which is significantly more than, you know, the $60 a year you'd pay for, say, the PlayStation Network.
Okay. Yeah, right.
And so you're paying for that so that you have access to leaderboards and tournaments. I can't justify the price, you know, of that much. But again, they seem that it's really hidden on the website. Which is why are you guys hiding this instead of being clean up front? Because all you do,
a little bit opaque on the website, if you like.
Yeah,
but doesn't it also give you access to games as well? Like you get games with that too, don't you? Like it's part of your subscription.
You do get games as part of your subscription, but now you start asking yourself, well, is it worth that much? So, for instance, if you're paying that. The announced Zacharia packs you'll have access to. So you won't have to be paying those. Now, how much are those Zacharia packs going to cost? They're selling them at $50 per volume. There's four volumes, so that's $200. So in a year and a half of subscription to the ArcadeNet, you could have purchased outright all those Zacharia tables.
And play them on the hardware. Locally.
Well, apparently you're still going to have to be downloading them to a thumb drive. Playing them that way. So you're still not playing them wirelessly, which is good. I'm glad they did that option.
Yeah, because that would not be fun.
No. And the pricing for the Zacharia, they is up front. They do say that easily. I initially thought that the pricing on that was really high until I looked at Steam and I realized, okay, Steam is saying they're selling their Platinum Bundle, which is everything that Zacharia has put out, including, so it's the original Zacharias, the EMs, the retros, remakes. The remakes. The only thing it doesn't include is the Deluxe. No Deluxe. Or excuse me, the Steam package does include the Deluxe, but the AtGames does not. Steam selling it for $215 full price. It's frequently, as it is right now, half off.
Yeah.
AtGames selling the same thing. They're selling it for $200. They were offering it for $100 if you bought it for the National Owners Day, but it's now back to full price.
Yeah.
How often are they going to be running the sale?
I don't know.
I don't either.
I don't think it's going to be as frequent as Steam.
No, although, probably not.
That being said, I'm not an AtGames product owner, so I'm not privy to their discount cycles. Right.
Now, the true insult, and again, this does not affect those that bought the pinball cab, but it does affect those that are with all the other Legends products. You want those Gottlieb games? Hey, if you own Steam, $40 gets you all of them.
That's a full price, right?
That's full price. That's not even on sale. $40 gets you all of them. Actually, it's $38. Pricing at games? $100.
For all four packs.
Well, they're selling it as a two-pack, $50 per pack. But my point being, that's some bonkers markup.
Yeah.
I mean, that's ballsy.
Well, you know, Farsight's going to make their money somehow.
I tell you. The other thing that bugs me is that they're always talking about, you know, oh, it comes with 300 licensed games. Oh, it comes with 150 licensed games. Good luck finding the list of games. I did a Google search because it's not on their website as far as I could tell. I had to do a Google search, which brought me to Reddit, which had a list of all the titles. And you go through the titles and you realize that most of them are Atari 2600, Sega Genesis, or Super NES games.
These are all the ones that are on your subscription.
Yes.
But there's fighting games there too, I'm sure, that you can get access to.
But there's none of them are name, like, of the, like, I just went through the list of 150 that came on their three-quarter scale arcade cabinet that they have with Tetris.
Yeah.
And literally, it's probably less than 20 that you would go, oh yeah, I know that game. Everything else, is, like, from the arcade. Everything else is home console stuff. And again, be upfront about it. List your games, but you're not listing the games. You're just saying it comes with all these licensed titles. And it's like, why are you being coy with that? Because we all.
I mean, unless your Google Foo skills are failing you and you can't use the internet to find stuff. Like, if anyone, again, on the flip side of this, to be fair, if we're doing it wrong, send us a link to where the pricing is and show us how you got there.
Yeah.
Like the steps you found, because we just may be missing it because we're not, you know, we're not customers. We may not be. Sometimes when you use these sort of ecosystems, you kind of got to understand how they've structured things before you can actually interact with the site. So fair call. If we're doing it wrong, call us out on it.
Now, all this is to say, though, we completely recognize that the difference between Arcade 1-Up and AtGames at its core is what is your intent with the machine. The AtGames customer is plug and play. That's all they're interested in. That's what they want it for. You do have people that are wanting to, on the arcade cabinet side, not the pinball side yet, are wanting to just toss in their own computer, toss in a Raspberry Pi, use it for the form factor only, and run with it and go with that. The Legends Pinball, it is very much designed for people that have every intent of bringing in all their own pinball. It has nothing to do with what they're offering as software.
They could easily just ship the cabinet without any software at all and put the interface boards in there without any ROMs, and probably no one would care. And that's probably it might sound like a nasty thing to say, but I don't see anybody talking about how much they're enjoying playing the Farsight software on their cabinets. All I see in the Facebook groups are people going, how do I get FX3 to play on this cabinet?
Yeah.
That's literally all I see. So they could probably do themselves a favor and just get rid of the software. And then if people want that particular software build natively available on their cabinets, then they can go and buy that as an extra cost.
Well, but see, I think the reason why they're putting the software on there, though, is they're making it sound like it's a selling feature, because really they're trying to sell subscriptions to ArcadeNet. Again, the cab is a loss leader. It's them getting their foot in the door and then just trying to get the monthly fee out of you.
It really is. Like, it seems to be very geared around that. And look, if that is the business model, then that's the business model.
Yeah.
When you purchase this product, if that's what they're intending you to do, then you go into that fully understanding that when you purchase the product.
But it's like, you know, people keep on trying to pit these two against each other as if one is Xbox and one is PlayStation. No, one is Xbox and one is mobile. it's yes, they play games, but it's two completely different audiences when it comes down to it.
Yeah. And we're not suggesting that from the mobile side that's at games as in like inferior or anything. It's
right.
Just that different is what we're trying to say here, is that it's not really comparable.
Yeah.
Like, one's literally a cabinet that you can extend to do stuff with that you want to do stuff with. The other one is a standalone product that's designed for one purpose only, and that is to play a specific build of a pinball system, pinball game, with a certain amount of interactivity that has been pre-designed to work with that system. And
right.
That's it.
So, there now that we've got all that out of the way, let's take the survey, Jared.
All right, survey time.
Time for the survey. Let's bring this up. Here is the first question. That is the desired scale size of the next AtGames Legends pinball machine. Do you want it to be tabletop size with no legs and a main display up to 15 inches? Do you want countertop size with no legs, main display size up to 19 inches? Do you want a 3/4 scale with its own legs and main display size up to 27 inches? Or do you want a deluxe version of the Legends pinball, i.e. the MSRP is hundreds of dollars more? Jared, which one did you select?
How did I vote?
Yes,
I voted 3/4 scale.
So you would like to see them do a 3/4 scale version, basically, of what currently is the Legends pinball, but just with the form factor size that will match everybody's 3/4 scale arcades that they've been building up.
Yeah, I ain't got the size for that current cabinet.
Okay.
Like, that's too big for my house at the moment. Give me a smaller form factor with all the features, and you got me interested.
So I was going to select that, and then I went and I selected the deluxe version
of the Legend
Pinball. Because, again, I think this is who they're gearing towards. They're trying to get the people that don't want to spend $4,000 on a virtual pinball machine. And I think that if they can come in at a much, much lower price point, that is a much better entry for people. Here's the thing, though, that I worry about what their deluxe version is. What makes it deluxe? Is it that it comes with that control top panel and it comes with the light gun? Or is it that they're going to be, you know, making it so that it hooks to a PC so much easier, that it has a true D&D display in it?
I think that is where they are going with it. Because remember that they are developing, or they have mentioned on a number of separate occasions, that they are developing like an interface board that will allow you to more easily integrate your PC with the cabinet.
Okay.
So you can actually utilize that second screen and that sort of thing. So at the moment, you have to go and take the back off, get this like interface board from the internet, from like a shop on the internet, and then you plug your second monitor into that, and it's a bit of a hassle. But they are making it so that you can just plug and play in a future board revision. And that's that whole open ecosystem thing they were talking about, where all the other like VPX developers can come in and use this board interface to integrate haptics and stuff with all their titles. So they're moving towards that direction already. So I think if they were going to do that, what they'd end up doing is roll all those things in together, and that will be the premium offering with probably a bigger display, or perhaps the entire back glass as a monitor, and then a region for the display, so you can just like do what you like on the back.
Right.
I reckon that's what they're going with there.
Which is what I'm hoping. That's why I went that way, because I was like, yeah, no, go just full hog, embrace that audience that you're trying to do go with and have. That being said, go ahead and do a tabletop. Sure, why not?
Yeah, why not?
You know,
yeah.
Again, Arcade 1-Up has done that with their... They've got their tabletop Pac-Man and, you know, Dig Dugs and stuff. Sure, there's a whole... There's room for it.
Yeah.
You know.
Why not everything?
Well, you know.
I don't know what the
difference is. I'm saying go high, go low. Don't go middle. Yeah. And I think if they went three-quarter, that's just going middle. That's going, you know, you're trying to... you're hoping to steal some thunder from the market that is clearly going one direction.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, let's go to the next question. Next question. Minimum number of licensed built-in games tables to be an attractive purchase option. 10 with an option to play, purchase, stream more through Legends Arcade platform, or 12 or 15 or 20 plus or other. Where'd you go?
I think I just went with 20 plus.
I went with 20 plus. And that was prior to me looking at what games they currently have. And then I just went, oh, yeah, you're giving me crap. So give me more crap.
Yeah. Load me up with crap. 20 plus crap, please. Yeah.
Yeah. 20 of junk is junk. If they really wanted to screw you, they'd give you 40. So,
yeah. That's right.
That was a modified Dennis Miller joke for those that know that one. Let's move on to the next one. For the pinball machine's exterior artwork, I want multi-cade style artwork, which is basically what they have right now, primarily based on one authentic IP design. Again, they did that with their Tetris cabinet. Doesn't matter as long as it's easy to replace. Basic black with minimal flourishes or other.
Yeah, signing up for basic black.
I went with basic black because they clearly proved to me that they do not know how to do multi-cade style artwork tastefully.
Just keep it black and get rid of the Legends Arcade branding off it.
Oh,
like,
my God. Seriously.
Just put it somewhere. Like, but just like on the side of the cabinet, fine. Just keep it off the back glass.
Yeah.
We don't need it up there.
Yeah. Like, because again, they're not going for the nostalgia retail factor with the licenses that they have is not going to pique my interest. So
no, just nice and simple. You could do a really elegant job of a nice, simple black design. Just blacker. Give me blacker.
Make it black. Next on the survey, in a lower cost 3/4 scale machine or smaller, is a secondary back glass display a requirement for you to purchase? Jared, your interpretation of that secondary back glass display. Do you think it just meaning a DMD, or are you talking about the full display?
Well, it's unclear.
So it is unclear.
The question is poorly worded, but I assumed that it was like the full back glass display, and I went with yes, and it needs to be included.
Yes, so for our audio-only listeners, the choices were yes, but it can be optional, yes, and it needs to be included, no, but I would want the option, and no, I don't need the option. Well, if you don't need the option, then you probably bought Well-Played's arcade cabinet that doesn't even have a score on the back glass.
That's right.
For it to be optional, well, I really don't need them to charge me $200 for an accessory of a monitor, as we're seeing that they'll do with other options. So, yes, yeah. I put you need it to be included. Absolutely.
Yep. Put it as part of the bill of materials up front so we don't have to go and add it after the fact.
Correct. All right. Next one. It is, in a lower cost 3/4 scale machine or smaller, is haptic feedback or the equivalent, I thought that was an interesting in parentheses there, a requirement for you to purchase? And once again, it's yes, but it can be optional. Yes, and it need to be included. No, but I would want the option. And no, I don't need the option or other.
Well, yes, and it needs to be included.
Absolutely, it does.
Yep.
Otherwise, and again, if you're talking about the tabletop kind of thing, well, if it's not included, now we're getting into that market where I can just slide in an iPad and play that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know.
Absolutely.
So, no, be different. Be unique to the marketplace or to the space.
That is a selling feature of a product, like having haptics built in, that you just can't get with one of those iPad arcade style things.
In a lower cost 3/4 scale machine or smaller, is a spring-loaded plunger a requirement for you to purchase? Yes, I don't like plunger buttons. No, a plunger button is fine. Or other?
Yes. You need to put one in.
Yes, indeed. Especially since you're going to have 105 Zachariah tables, and they were all designed with a plunger in mind. Oh, all those Gottlieb tables, other than no good gophers, basically, all designed with a plunger in mind. You need the plunger.
Yeah, that's right. They have going nuts in there. Because that's just button. Well, that's auto launch, actually.
Yeah, that one's just plain auto. It's not even an option at all.
It's plunger or nothing.
The only way that I would accept a button only is if a single tap on the button moved the plunger back a little bit incrementally so that I could just go tap, 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 and then a long press, and then that does the launch. But this business of holding it in and watching the plunger go, because the plunger just goes too fast. You're never going to get that skill shot, ever.
I've tried using the button method on Zachariah Pinball, and it's like, and it literally goes like that. There's no way you can get an accurate plunger shot on that. Although, to be fair, on a lot of the Zachariah Pinballs, there's actually no skill shot on them anyhow. You're just launching the ball into play.
But you still can do a soft launch and have it drop in earlier parts of the table, as opposed to going all the way around, the loop.
True. Well, actually, on some tables, there is actually a plunge drop zone. Like, you've got, So on some of the ones, they have, an upper sort of ramp that the ball drops through onto the lower play field that will award you points. So, yeah, there is a skill shot element to some of them. So, you need to be able to accurately shoot for that because, just like Roger Sharp did, you can't break the... break the lock on gambling with pinball machines if you have a button.
Right. Next up, for a tabletop-sized pinball machine with no legs and main display of up to 15 inches and the features you indicated you want, how much would you be willing to pay?
I think
15 inches and below.
Yeah, so basically a large tablet.
Yes.
So this is for me, this is with the back glass, with the haptics, with the plunger.
Yeah.
I went up to 200.
That is where I landed also.
Mm.
And I mean, because look, I could easily say, oh, I only want to pay $100, but it's going to be crap. I do understand building costs.
Let's be reasonable. There's money in those parts. So, yes.
I that's why I went 200 seemed about reasonable. And that's also, and again, I'm looking at what Arcade 1UP has done with their tabletop units. I think their Pac-Man is only a 10-inch screen. That's in that one, and they sell it for 200. So, I'm going with what market rate is.
It seems reasonable. I'm sure they could work it out. Yeah.
For a countertop-sized pinball machine with no legs and a main display size of up to 19 inches and the features you indicated you want, how much would you be willing to pay?
Well, we're talking about an extra 4 inches here,
Chris.
So I'm really only going to be going up to about 350 for that.
I think I went to 300.
Did you?
I think that's all I was willing to go to because I don't suspect that the back glass is going to be any larger. For the display, I think it would literally be just your main display being different, and that's about the extent of it.
I think you're probably right there. That seems fairly logical because all you'd do is you'd just increase the size of the box to accommodate the larger screen in the bottom half of the playfield, and then your back box probably would be a standard back box for those particular build types.
Yeah, so, I mean, you can even though the back box, I want to say perspective, that's not the right word.
For scale,
it's going to maybe get bigger. I still think the monitor that would be inside that back box would stay the exact same.
It would be a marquee, wouldn't it? I think they'd surround it in some sort of bezel or marquee.
Yeah.
And I think, that would be perfectly reasonable for them to do that. Because again, they have to mount the thing inside the cabinet, inside the back box. So there's going to be some rough edges that they need to cover up anyhow. It won't just be a slot in sort of thing. So yeah, fair call. If they had marquee or bezel in the back box, they could use that to their advantage and actually cut the cost there. So that's possible, right?
And then if you were able to buy your own pinball legs and attach them to that, those are going to run you about $80 for those, and now you're up to $400, which is the same price as the Toy Shock.
Well, yeah, the Toy Shock.
So.
Yeah.
All right. For a deluxe version of the Legends Pinball Machine and the features you indicated that you want, how much would you be willing to pay? Up to $1,000, up to $950, up to $900, up to $850, up to $800, or just not interested?
Because it's hard to work out what they're going to put into it and what's not going to be there, I'd say, look, up to $1,000. But for that $1,000, it'd better be pretty schmick.
I went ahead and went 900. I think you need to stay away from the 1,000 mark. Yeah. It's a huge...
mental jump.
And especially if you're talking about throwing in shipping.
That's
you
like
need to be below.
Yeah, you're over that 1,000 then.
Yeah, and if we're talking about what we were talking about having it be with the deluxe... there's not going to be much more. I mean, yes, the back glass might have a bigger monitor in it, but I don't think that your main playfield is going to have a bigger monitor, per se. I think they're going to be fine with that 32-inch that they already have in there, unless they really scale up the cab. But they're talking about a deluxe version of the Legends pinball. So I'm saying they're going to use that same cabinet. They're going to use probably all the same hardware, all the same buttons. That main playfield is going to be the same monitor. They'll change out the back glass, put in a DMD, move the inputs, make it so that you can mount a computer inside. You know, make it put a door on the back or something like that, so you can mount a computer directly into it.
Yep,
$900. That's what I'm talking.
You're at 900, eh? Yeah, right.
Yeah.
You know, I think if that was what they were going to do, then that'd be fine. But if they were going to upscale that to more of a traditional, pinball cabinet size, a 42-inch monitor and a larger everything, then well and truly that would be $1,000. And I think, you know, if they were going to go down that route, that's my idea of premium, because they've done a good job with what they've got for that price point.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what we're talking about, 600, right?
Yeah.
If you sort of like get up to nearly double that, then there's a bigger cabinet, I think, would be something that people would really go nuts for, and a larger monitor in there, that would be a lot of people just be, they couldn't throw money at the screen hard enough for that product, I don't think.
Yeah, but again, you're talking, there's a certain break in price points where it's hard to justify the money after a while. You know what I mean?
Well, when you look at a full price digital pinball machine for over $4,000.
Yeah, but what I'm talking about is none of these people are in the market for it. They want one, but nobody's in the market for it.
Well, I don't know. I think that people would go, if they could knock out a 42-inch monitor version of the Arcade Legends for around $1,000, and even if that meant they had to sacrifice some of the things I wanted on my wish list, people would be lining up for that. They would want it hard. If they could get their hands on one for that, because that would mean that their mates, when they go over to their place and look at their swanky $4,000 digital pinball machine, they could go, "Yeah, I got that for a quarter of the price through AtGames."
Because here's the other thing: you're still going to have to pay for your own computer. That computer with the graphics card, the necessary to run this, you're still going to be at about $600 for that computer. So that's going to be an add-on price to that. Now, if you're at $1,000 for their cab and their choice of monitors, and you throw in that $600, there's a lot of people that do DIY with a 42-inch or 40-inch monitor for $2,000. So that's what I'm saying. You start getting into that range where, well, now you can just do it because you're already in that tinkering mode. So if you want to get the largest audience for this kind of thing, you're going to have to come in significantly lower than what is available already for better. Because otherwise you're going to start getting into direct comparisons where people are sitting there going to be, you know, they're going to be, you know, going, "Hey, look at my VP cabs unit compared to this." And, you know, the Legends is going to look like it's going to look like Toy Shock, you know, in comparison. So
yeah,
there is that, you know, if the car market, you know what I mean? And you can't, you got to realize who your audience is, not who your audience wants to be, but who your audience actually is. And there is luxury within that audience before bumping into a whole nother category. You know, so that it's the people that will trick out their Honda because they can't afford a BMW. And they're coming, they're butting up right against the price of an entry-level Beamer, but they're not, you know, there. And I don't know. That's just where my head is thinking.
It's going to be really interesting to see what they do with this data and where people sat on it. Like, yeah. It'd be interesting if you've done the survey as well and you're listening to this. Where do you sit on the scale? Like, you know, what do you think feels right in this current market with those questions? Like, for me, like, if I'm reading between the lines, we're going to see a 3/4 size pinball machine this year from AtGames. Like, that line of questioning that they're going for in the survey.
Yes.
They're seriously eyeballing the 3/4 scale market.
Absolutely.
Yep.
All right, let's go on to the final question.
Okay, what is the final question?
What would your desired use cases be for this type of product? To mostly play the built-in pinball games? To play multiplayer pinball with other Legends Arcade family devices? To play arcade and other non-pinball games on the vertical screen? To play games from other devices, PC, Raspberry Pi, etc.? To have an easily transportable pinball option? I don't know yet, and other.
So I really couldn't care less about the built-in pinball games on them. I think we've covered that pretty extensively.
Yep.
So certainly not that question. To play multiplayer pinball with other Legends Arcade family devices? Nope, because streaming.
Yep.
To play arcade and other non-pinball games on the vertical screen? Nice feature. Not the primary reason, because I'd want to play games from other devices on this product. And that's all I want to do with it. Right. It will be a cabinet for my other things that I've got. That's it. That's the purpose of this product for me.
Honestly, I put to have an easily transportable pinball option. Because no, again.
So you're saying that you would move around Legends Pinball in the current form factor. So I'm going to take this with me under my arm.
Well, it's not that it's take it with me under my arm, but I don't like any of these answers, to be honest.
Are really strong enough. See, I think
my answer for wanting a virtual pinball cabinet by AtGames would be basically to be playing, let's be truthful, you're going to be sitting there going to Visual Pinball and downloading those things. And so I want it to be the easiest functionable way of playing those. I don't care about the built-in pinball games they're offering. I don't, you know, because I don't think they're the best built designs out there. I mean, I'm not discounting Zacharia. I think they've done a bang-up job. But in terms of if I wanted to play Gottlieb's, I'm pretty sure that there's better builds in Visual Pinball than what Farsight did.
Yeah.
And then I want to play all my Bally Williams. I'm going to be going Visual Pinball on that. That's the answer that I really want.
Yeah, the thing is that you can't play any Visual Pinball tables except the ones sanctioned by AtGames through their services. So you are going to be basically playing games from other devices on your computer in that case.
Which is where it becomes, I don't care about their services.
Yeah.
That's not a factor to me, because
you're just plugging your PC. So, so when you say transportable, is your interpretation of transportable as in a flexible solution? Not physically, I can move it from one place to another place.
Pretty much.
See, I've interpreted that question
I was thinking in my head, you know, again, hey, if I want a large machine that has 1,000 pinball games on it, well, it's much more easily transportable in one box than it is to have, you know, 1,000 physical machines that you're trying to transport. But
yeah, that's true.
I mean, I probably should have selected other. And I didn't really think about that.
Yeah.
But
I interpreted transportable to mean, like, if they're angling more towards the 3/4 pinball size or the tabletop market.
Honestly, I think it's more the tabletop market. Would that be what that is?
that's what that question seems to cover, although it's broad in the way they've asked it. They didn't really design the survey super well. I guess it's easy to say. Creating surveys that are good takes a lot of skill.
Yeah.
And it's hard to get them right. So the thing we shouldn't be focusing on is the construction of the survey. And the thing we should be focusing on here is the fact that they are asking their customers these questions openly so that they can actually feed back to them what they want as consumers for the future of the product. And that should be commended. That's really good to see.
Which, again, circles back to when you've got these kind of pre-orders coming in and how excited people are for this, it allows you the opportunity to stretch and go beyond and try and hit all your customer bases and give them all these options, and that is a very good thing.
A very good thing. So kudos to AtGames for going down this path and doing this, because it's a really good thing to see them thinking about this and getting good, accurate customer data back that allows them to make a good, logical decision about the future of the product lines. Good on them for that.
So like I said at the start, yeah, we're going to be critical. But we're trying to be constructive, critical.
Yeah. Hopefully this episode's come across like that. I think we managed to do it. I guess the YouTube comments will tell us if we have.
Well, I'm sure that we'll get our thumbs down like within 5 seconds of it premiering anyway, because you know, how dare us mention AtGames in our show.
Yeah. Whatever.
It's just like, what, you guys are no, you guys are the Zen hack boys. You how dare you talk about AtGames?
Whatever.
Exactly. Yeah, whatever.
Please be welcome. Your thumbs down anytime. Bring it on.
Well, no, I don't want them to bring it on, because that does affect our, our YouTube channel.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. I don't like that necessarily. You know, I understand if you give us a thumbs down for a reason, you know, feel free to comment, but if you just throw us a thumbs down and walk away, that's just a cheap shot.
Yeah.
All right. Anyway. That's our show for today, folks. Do hope that you enjoyed it. Thank you for sitting through all of this and walking through this journey with us. Please go ahead and sign up for this channel. Go ahead and hit us up on Twitter and follow us there so that you can see all the info that we collect throughout the weeks while we're on our downtime. And like we said, new schedule. We're going to be basically doing every other week. We will be touching upon the pinball show and what they talk about this upcoming week when their show airs. But our show will be the following weekend.
That's right. So we'll give you all time to digest it yourself before we bombard you with our opinions.
It'll probably also help us be able to, you know, kind of see what take the temperature of the community of what this said and what they're thinking of. You know, we can help you guys out with your feelings.
Yeah. We'll see how that goes.
But until then, we never know what our next show is going to be, because, you know, we never know what the news is going to be. But there's one thing that we can guarantee our show will be about.
Stuffing things.
Not stuffing things. Stuff and things.
Stuffing things. Yeah.
All right, folks, until next time. Bye-bye.
See you later.